conversation with Clarence Morgan. Clarence will discuss this exhibition series titled Linear Fictions, and as well as what he has been creating since Linear Fictions. We would like this conversation to be casual and interactive, so please feel free to ask questions throughout the conversation. Linear Fictions is in the gallery through Saturday, November 27th. You can also view the exhibition online at burnetart.com. And we have an exhibition catalog, which is the red book, available for purchase for you to look at. Clarence Morgan is a visual artist based in painting and drawing with additional experience in printmaking. Drawing has been the central inquiry of Morgan's practice for over four decades. Using a variety of tools and mixed media, Morgan has developed a unique drawing process of layered mark making that employs chance operations and improvisation in both minimal and complex compositions. Morgan is a native of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, where he also received his formal education and art training. He is based in Chicago and Minneapolis, where he is a professor of art at the University of Minnesota. During his career, Clarence has been an artist in residence at the McCall Center for Visual Art in Charlotte, North Carolina, and the Harvard Museum of Art in Taos, New Mexico. His list of solo exhibitions include Rosenberg and Kaufman Fine Art in New York, Kittersmith Gallery in Boston, Thomas Gary Fine Arts in Minneapolis, David Lux Gallery in Memphis, and the Morris Gallery of the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts in Philadelphia, among others. Group exhibitions, in which his paintings, drawings, and prints were featured, include the American Academy Institute of Arts and Letters in New York, David Richard Contemporary Santa Fe, Walker Art Center in Minneapolis, Minneapolis Institute of Arts, and the Rochester Art Center. Clarence has been invited to produce prints at Tamarind Institute in Albuquerque, New Mexico, High Point Center for Printmaking in Minneapolis, Brandywine Workshop in Philadelphia, and the Patton Convention Studio Workshop at the Anderson Ranch Art Center in Snowmass Village, Colorado. His work is in the permanent collections of the Cleveland Museum of Art, the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts, the Walker Art Center, Minneapolis Institute of Art, and the Frederick R. Weissman Art Museum, among others. Linear Fictions was created by Clarence during 2020. I thought I would start with a quote by Clarence. I think the significance of this work with the Linear Fiction series, unlike anything that I have done, is that I created them in a situation where I had no control. So I thought now would be the time to give it to Clarence.
Okay, thank you. Thank you all. I mean, it's so nice to see so many familiar faces here, but I'm reminded of a number of people in the Minneapolis St. Paul community that I haven't had the pleasure of meeting. So many of you I'm sort of meeting or seeing for the first time. So thank you for taking time out of your schedule to come here this evening. As Jennifer pointed out, we'd like this to be a conversation. I taught today, so I'm in teacher mode, but I know that there are a few students here, but the majority of you are not my students, so I don't want to lecture you. So we can have a conversation. And this is an opportunity for you to ask questions about the work and or about me or anything. So let's keep it informal. We can start off with maybe, I think the catalog, there's a wonderful essay in the catalog by Tia Simone Gardner, who teaches at McAllister, when she invited me to the studio. And to be honest, I've had a lot of things written about my work over the years. Most of what has been written is by art historians, curators, mostly men, mostly white. And the approach that they take in looking at my work, it's always formal. Maybe that's because of their training, because of their positions maybe the conversation, I mean, we do know why I made the work that's on the wall, because of the circumstances that happened. And again, I'll sort of reiterate just a little bit, just in case somebody missed it. So, during spring break of 2020, I went out to visit my son in Castro Valley, California, because they just bought a new house, very expensive house. He works for Facebook, Stanford grad. And so I went out to see the new house with he and Emily, his partner, with plans to stay for 8 days during spring break. In March, if you can remember, March of 2020, all hell broke loose with COVID, George Floyd, riots, everything. So we made the executive decision that it wouldn't be safe for me to go to the San Francisco airport and get on a plane with COVID running rampant and fly back to Minneapolis. By that time, the University of Minnesota had pivoted to online remote teaching because they didn't want the students coming back in Acapulco or wherever they were, bringing COVID back here. So I just said, well, I can teach my classes from Northern California, which I did. What I didn't plan for was that I only took about 8 days of underwear and clothes with me, and I ended up staying there for 6.5 months. So Amazon made a lot of money off of me. I'm buying clothes and things like that. The bedroom was probably about 8 by 9 inches. I mean, feet, excuse me. It felt inches. One window, no closet, and a dresser, which I used as a drawing table. And that's where all these drawings were made. Now, on the good days, and I say good days, before the fires came, I would take the drawings outside and I would work by the pool, which he had a pool in his house, and I would work outside. Then when the fires came, we couldn't do that anymore. So not only did we have social distancing, quarantine, but the air quality from the fires, you know, it was just really not a good situation. But in order to keep myself sane, and maybe that's a little too strong of a word, to keep myself occupied, I started doing these drawings. And I think there's 57 up right now, and I think I did about 130. And I was speaking to someone earlier this evening about, in those kind of situations, and I don't want to, yeah, I've never been to prison before. I don't want to go to prison, but I can imagine that someone who's incarcerated, whose physical environment is contained in a small place, that you develop, you have a few routines that you do, and you do them over and over and over again. And I think the drawings are a result of me doing these routines over and over and over again. You couldn't really go outside, or you didn't want to go outside, you didn't want to socialize, you had all your food delivered, and so you find yourself trying to figure out what to do with your time. So the drawings are sort of where I put my thought life for those 6.5 months. And, you know, as I look at the work, part of it is unfamiliar to me. Almost in the way that when we think back to March and we think about, you know, the all the unknowns about COVID, and then we see on CNN and CNN News and all that, the stuff about the riots and all that was going on, you know, it almost seems like a distant memory, but those things did happen. You know, and so when I think about this work, it seems like a distant memory. It's almost like I don't even recognize this work anymore. You know, it's been, a little more than a year. But the circumstances that, and the situation that they were done in was so abnormal. And that time period was so abnormal. You know, getting back here and then you have the Chauvin trial going on, and you have the National Guard, people with automatic weapons walked up and down Washington Avenue and barricades, and this, it was just abnormal. This was completely, totally freaky. And I know you guys live in rice flour. The country people didn't know where it was. Now they do. Now they know where it is. The whole world knows where it is. So it's an unfathomable thing that's happening. So that's the circumstances. That's the backdrop from a lot of work. Now, you know, from that, then you say, well, they look so beautiful. They don't look like they were created out of this torment, the social torment that was happening. The colors are bright, they're not dark, they're kind of happy and jubilant looking drawings. And I don't know how to respond to that, but the only thing that I can think of is that the linear aspects, hence the title of linear fiction, the lines that are used are very compressed and very dense. And I think about things being compressed, time being compressed, emotions being compressed, you know, things being very dense, you know, socially things are very dense, culturally things are very dense, racially things are very dense. The density of things, the weight, the almost, you know, the lines can't even get out of each other's way. They're just layered on each other, collisions, all those kind of things. And so if I had to kind of go on about this, that's the way that I would reflect on that. Now, when I did the work, I wasn't thinking of those things at all. I mean, you know, my little adage is, when my hands are busy, my mind does its best work. So actually, when my hands are busy, I can shut my mind off, and so my hands do all the work. It's like being an automatic pilot. I don't have to think about doing those drawings. My hands do all the thinking for me. So there's not, if somebody says, what were you thinking about when you did this drawing? I haven't the slightest idea. I mean, thought doesn't really create the drawings. You know, my hands create the drawings. Being visceral, you know, and, you know, using your hands and having your hands kind of telling you what to do. And so you follow your hands. It's not the mind telling your hands what to do. It's the kind of the hands telling the mind to shut up. You know, and I think about it that way. If I think about things too much, I get really stupid fast. because my thinking just gets all caught up. It trips over itself and stuff like that. Just I try not to. The thing, and it doesn't mean that the drawings lack intelligence. But that kind of tells us that we need to think about what intelligence really is. I mean, there's IQ, but there's emotional intelligence as well. You know, that's a different kind of intelligence. So my hands are intelligence. I just, you know, it's kind of where my brain appeared. But our hands are intelligent. Every part of our body has its own form of intelligence to it. If you listen to it, at least I think that way too. So. I think, you know, most people, I don't think their brains, I'm not throwing my brain under the bus, but my brain has let me down far many, too many times, too many times it has let me down. So trusting in other parts of our emotional self is equally as important that we should not forget. I reveal myself to you. Now you reveal yourself to me. Got it.
You mentioned that due to the circumstances.
I know it's hard to.
Sure. Yeah. It's Charlie there.
Hey, Charlie!
You mentioned that due to the circumstances, you didn't recognize or use some phrase like that, some of the art. As time has passed between when you created other projects, do you not recognize them in a similar manner, or is this different? Definitely different in that regard.
Good question. You know, Holly knows that we, in the last, how long have we been working on this exhibition project now?
2 months.
2 months, and we've been pulling out hundreds of paintings that go back as far as 1972. Artworks that I did when I was 22 years old in Philadelphia. And I pull those work out, and you see me, that, that's kind of close to what I'm doing now. And so there's a distance between this feeling and that feeling. Although you can say that there's some of the same DNA in here, but there's some other moves in here that don't exist in here. Now again, this wasn't done in the same circumstances as those. So I don't, I'm not interested in recreating this anymore. It's yesterday's newspaper, you know, and so I'm thankful that Jennifer gave me the opportunity to present this work because I could see it afresh and it gives other people the opportunity to see it. But you know, I don't want to say that I'm just interested in it, but to some degree I am disinterested in it at this particular point. I don't hate it. I'm just interested in what tomorrow brings, not what yesterday brought. Not only that answer the question, Sean, but it's a good question. It's a good question. Yes, Joanne.
So I'm kind of wanting to stand up for these because I feel like you're letting them go as you move toward the next thing. Because when I look at these, I don't want to stop looking at them. And there's a kind of, the, you know, the word meditative came to mind. But I don't like that so much because it feels, I think more interesting, they feel so alive. They feel like they're moving and changing as I watch them, which I realize is actually something that they're creating in me. And the other language that came to my mind was that they seem finished but not resolved. And I think about that whole year, you know, how uncertain it was. And I think that for a lot of us, I hope, I certainly feel it, I think you do, I know other artists who feel that something happened that was life-changing and that we will never pop out into a new normal that is the same or different, you know, V2 of the old normal, but that it created an opportunity and a necessity because we couldn't see each other, we couldn't watch our loved ones die, and all kinds of things that you talked about having to do with racism and, you know, people being sick, just all kinds of things. And that these, I feel like that kind of context created something that has to do with being, just being, not in with any judgment, not that it was good, not that it was bad, but that there's a simplicity to it and a complexity to it that doesn't get tied up. It's not something you can say, well, this is what this is about. And that feels like a real gift to the person who looks at it. I get it that you don't want to hover over it and keep, you know, like milking it for some, you know, into the future. But I also think that this, the thing that happened to all of us, probably to some extent, is really worth identifying, which you have done in this work, and just honoring, which is happening in this exhibition, even though you don't want to go back there, even though you don't want to stay there, but it's something that probably won't happen again. And it feels like there's real value for, and what I'm finding looking at it, and Jen said this too, you know, I could just sit and look at a few, I like them together, not, I don't need the whole show, but I like at least two together, because there's so much difference in the way that you've, I'm talking too much, you should.
I think these are good points, and I really appreciate the generosity. You know, the exhibition is a way for me to share myself with others, you know, and I think that's it. But you also brought up another point, in my suggestion that I don't want to go back. On December, this coming December the 16th will be the fifth year of the death of my wife. We were married for 46 years. And that's a process that I'm not bored with. And someone I was talking to,
talking about the future of your work, do you think that this collection informed your current studio practice at all?
Everything is related. Mm-hmm. Everything is related, whether I'm conscious of it or not. The same hands that did that is the same hands that did this, will be the same hands of the work that I do next month. So it's all connected. Mm-hmm.
Do you feel like when you got back and you were in the space that you were familiar with, that you kind of went back to the same processes? Or do you think that they shifted a little bit?
Well, I think about this work, and jokingly, it's like trying to cook Thanksgiving Day dinner in somebody else's kitchen, right? You don't have all of your normal stuff to work with, so you have to add it in, you have to do what you have. But when I got back to my studio in Minneapolis, I had all my stuff, you know, so I had more tools, I had more things, I could do more things with it. That work, this work, Linear Fictions, was done. I mean, the material is very simple. It's a black marker and colored pencil. That's it. That's all I had. You know? When I got back home, you've been to my studio. I got loads of stuff to do work with, you know. But it's kind of interesting what happens when you're reduced to very little that you have to sort of make do with what you have. And that's where invention happens.
Sometimes have these like axes running through the compositions.
is the relationship between chaos and order?
Yeah.
And I tend to believe that there cannot be any order unless there is chaos, and there can't be any chaos unless there is order. That if you repeat chaos enough, it will turn into order. And if you compress order upon order upon order, it will turn into chaos. And so I think both of those are necessary. So the drawings do look very chaotic in some ways. Someone said this about, not this work, but some other work that I do, because I'm kind of like compulsive about my lines. I can never have enough lines, you know? And they said, well, gee, the work is very interesting. There's a whole lot to look at, but there's nothing to see. I didn't know if that was a compliment or not, but I don't know what that results in. The idea that they do look very disorienting, but as you look around the room, there is an order to the mayhem. Mm-hmm. There's an order to the mayhem in some ways. You notice how most of them are centered in the middle of the page. That's the order. Nothing goes off the page. That's order. You know, there are subtle differences between as we go around the room. Some seem to be more dense than others. I don't know what to say about that, other than the fact that depending whether that was done in the third month or the fourth month, that kind of changed. Maybe the weather had something to do with it. Maybe my own fatigue had something to do with it. There are fewer lines or more lines in some than others. I'm surprised nobody talked about the color, because that's the other thing too. It's like, you know, what determines the color of these things too? And you know, I don't really have any strategic response to the colors. I think that sometimes I will tend to lean more towards a warmer palette or a cooler palette. It's not so much about color, but it's about warming. Well, it's not about red, blue, or green, but it's about warm, cool. You know, pushing things against the way things, the way that we think things are supposed to be, you know. And so I think there's a little bit of that in me. And again, you know, I was in my 20s in the 70s, and so, you know, some say I was the most kind of interested in music that was ever made, whether it be jazz or whether it be R&B or whether it be you know, people like Janis Joplin and you know, 10 Wheel Drive or the Chicago Transit Authority or any of those groups that would push the music. Rare Earth, for example, you know, these bands. So you know, I kind of like that. I like the rebel part of it. It's not like what it's supposed to be. Yes,
one more.
Oh, go
so
ahead.
As you're saying this, and I was interested in what you were saying earlier about how a lot of the interpretations of your work early on were very formal, and
yes.
You know, what drew you to abstraction?
Very, very interesting. As you probably know, that the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts was probably the oldest art academy in the United States. It was founded in 1805. That's where Thomas Aikens, Mary Cassatt, Henry Oswald Tanner all worked there. So it's a very traditional figurative school. Its model was based in Europe. I was trained that way. You've seen the self-portrait that I did, kind of like a Bartley Andrews kind of self-portrait, who was also from Philly as well, that I was trained in. Probably around age 24 when I was at the academy, I don't think it was because I was smarter, I had a forethought, but I think I asked myself, if I continue to work like this, work the way that the people who trained me, who are all white, where is my voice in that? Where is my voice in that? And, you know, it's sort of like if you have a teenager and, you know, that funny age where they don't want to be like their parents, they'd rather be anybody else other than their parents. I wanted to be anything else other than the way that they were training me to paint figuratively, to draw figuratively. So abstraction seemed to offer the most freedom, although I didn't understand abstraction. I thought abstraction was, in the 70s, I thought it was fraudulent. It's like anybody can do. You know, I was trained strict observation, drawing the figure, painting the figure, painting it faithfully. But now I want to break away from that. So where do I go? Well, abstraction seemed to offer the most freedom. So I started moving in that direction, really backing into it, you know, accidentally. Starting with geometric abstraction, just making shapes and filling them in that weren't objects, that weren't realistic anymore, and doing that. And that's what it is. So the real question is, I was searching for a voice that was not that voice. But I didn't know what voice it was. And abstraction made itself available to me in a very innocent, naive way, you know, because I didn't understand that. Asked me in 1974 about Jackson Pollock, I'm going back. I mean, in retrospect now, I kind of understand a little bit more, but I wasn't trained that way, so I had no backing to understand his art historically. So I was looking for something that would give me the most freedom and the most flexibility. That abstraction kind of opened its arms to me and welcomed me. And then I never looked back.
Did you know Clarence Woods?
I knew Clarence Wood at the Museum of Fuller Museum of Art.
And also his own
work. I didn't know, he was older than I was, you know, and so, but I knew of him at that point. But, you know, in the 70s, it was people like, Bartley Hendricks went to the Academy, and I went to the Academy, and Raymond Saunders went to the Academy, and a whole lot of other people went to the academy. It was in the 70s, they were opening doors to African Americans going to school, and then, but Bartley not exactly chronological in terms of when they were done, so
yeah,
that kind of linear narrative. That's why the word fiction is in here too. It's kind of all made up. It's all made up. It's all made up.
It almost seems more like a diary.
You know, that's an interesting word because, you know, 6.5 months, I would probably do at least, on a good day, I might do two. On a not so good day, I might complete one.
Yeah.
But, you know, in a week, you know, you can get about 5 or 6 drawings. So, like you would have diary entries in your book, you kind of do that. This is the daily work. This is the daily work. Well, I wrote something that wasn't pertaining to this show, but I thought about it. What does it mean to capture in words or images the vicissitudes of an artist's thought life, emotions, and spirit? So, what does it mean to capture in words or images, my words and these images, the vicissitudes, which we all know what that word is, it's a change of circumstance or fortune, typically one that is unwelcome, like what happened in Minneapolis. All of that was unwelcome. We welcome that here, you know, or unpleasant, which it was. So, how do you capture those vicissitudes in an artist in words or images? And maybe the work does try in some ways to capture these vicissitudes, these things that were happening that were unwelcome and unpleasant. Two, embedded in all of my work are the highs and lows of life. Embedded in all the words are the highs and lows of life. There is always an undercurrent that is mostly unseen. That is mostly unseen. So your point about the diary, your point about the narrative, there is an undercurrent story that is not necessarily seen in the work, but is nevertheless there because it was done by a living human being who had a life, who has a story.
Do you feel like certain of the pieces carry different memories from your time in California?
Mm-hmm.
Or do they all kind of blend together?
Yeah, it's kind of like a big play-doh ball that just gets switched together again. Yeah, I've had some other people come in early, I mean, not tonight, but before, and they were looking to purchase some works or buy some things, and they were kind of making these kind of selections, you know, they were favoring, you know, that, you know, that's what it considered, you know, Lowry Sims told me one day, he said, you know, like, we all think that the word discrimination is a bad word, because none of us like to discriminate, you know, it's a bad word. But what a curator does, they discriminate, you have to discriminate. And all that means is that you prefer one thing over another, you know. And so why did these people come in and they were looking at all these drawings and they were making discriminating decisions about which one to purchase. They were, I like this one better than that one, you know. So they were kind of doing that. But I don't see them that way. It was just all one month. I don't have a favorite child in all in any of these. They're all part of the same effort, the same emotional. Yeah.
Did you very often start one and say work for 20 minutes or a few hours and then chuck it in the garbage can?
I never throw anything away. I never abort anything.
Whoa.
Never. Never. I don't see the upside in that. Everything has a chance. Everything has a chance. I mean, you know, there's some that kind of go like, you know, there's some that are like, oh, I use the same color the same way in that one, so that's not, but I don't abort it though. You know, it kind of deserves to live. And that gets into, well, what do you do when you make mistakes? Well, first thing when I make mistakes is I don't believe in mistakes. Everything happens for a reason. You know, just sort of go with the flow. You know, and if it fails, failure is a part of trying. You know, so you kind of think about it that way. So, you know, I don't get bent out of shape about when things don't go my way, whatever that is, my way. What about the work's way? Why am I being so selfish? Why does the work have to obey what I want all the time? Can I just see what it wants to do, you know, and let it have its own way. It wasn't what I expected, but it's there. Let it live. Let it live. I say that as an adopted child. Let it live. Have you had enough?
I just want to come back to this idea that you're in the middle of air you can't breathe, racist, the uncovering of racism in Minnesota, which has had the persona of being nice, you know, that whole thing, the pandemic, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, politics. And they look so, I forget what the word is, which is so great.
What was that word?
They're just sort of learning, but they're also, there's such a beauty and a, I don't want to say peacefulness, they are disoriented, I think that's a great word, but there is a meditative, so there's this opposite, right? And I wonder if the process allowed you to stay in balance. You said started to say and sort of took it back before, that they kept you sane. But it's like that. I just think that's really interesting that the world was such a mess, and these pictures seem so, I don't know the words to use for them, but it seems like there's a hope in a way,
well, I mean,
in the process.
I mean, that's